Welcome, I'm Mark from ApplyGodsWord.com, a place where we apply the Bible to real life. We're trying to take God's timeless truth that's lasted forever, but applying it to modern times and questions. One of the topics that gets the most attention on my website and the YouTube channel is whenever the topic of masturbation comes up. A little bit awkward, but it's something extremely important because it's a question a lot of people are asking. In another video, I talked about, you know, what the Bible really says about masturbation. In this video, I'm going to be talking about 5 ways to stop masturbating if that's a sin that you're stuck in. And number one, the first thing I would say is you have to come to grips with what the Bible actually says about masturbation. Again, I talk about this more in the other video I created, but in summary, a lot of people believe that the Bible doesn't talk about masturbation. But I argue that it doesn't necessarily talk about it, but it does address it. The Bible doesn't list every single thing that you could ever do wrong. The Bible doesn't talk about, you know, pirating videos right now or stealing through downloading music illegally. But we know that's a sin because it's under the category of theft. Likewise, masturbation is a sin through what category it's in. For example, in 1 Corinthians 7, verses 5 and 9, Paul talks to the married and to the single. And basically, he gives them 2 categories for their sexuality. Number one, if you're married, you're only supposed to experience sexual things with your spouse. It says, do not deprive each other except by mutual consent so that you may come together again, and that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. So again, he says, either A, come together again, or B, you're falling to Satan's temptation. And he gives the same 2 categories for those who are single. He says in verse 9 that if you burn with passion, you should get married. Or he says you need to abstain. Like, there's only 2 options. There's no masturbation category of fulfilling some sexual experience by yourself. So the Bible condemns masturbation through what it condones. The only thing the Bible supports is a sexual experience between a husband and a wife. So we have to come to grips with that, or else we're going to, you know, not have the conviction to stop when those moments of temptation come. Like, well, I'm not really sure if it's even a sin, so boom, there you go, you fall into that sin again. The second thing kind of flows out of what we just talked about. And it's this: don't use weird mental tactics to justify this sin. A lot of people will try to play mind games. Well, if I think about a girl I really want to marry and she doesn't have a boyfriend or she's not married, then it's probably not lust. No, that is still lust. That's not what God has intended for you. Or some people have told me, like, well, I can masturbate with a blank mind, so it's not lust because I'm really not thinking about anything. It's just this biological experience. But again, we have to stick to what the Bible really says. And masturbation, orgasm, whatever, is a sexual experience. So you can't play these weird mind games to justify it. For example, it says in Romans 13, verse 14, it says, rather clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. So it really does start in the mind when it comes to overcoming sexual temptation. The third thing I would say, if you want to stop masturbating, is that you have to look forward to the reward that you will get if you don't fall to this instant gratification. God is a God of pleasure. He constantly motivates his people in the Word by promising them pleasures and blessings when they obey him. So if you want to stop falling to sexual temptation, whether it be masturbation, porn, lust, whatever, any sin really, even not in the sexual category, the real key is to look ahead to the greater promise of reward. Sin captures us. Temptation trips us up because it promises us something. It promises us pleasure and reward. And our hearts were designed for those types of things. The way you overcome that false promise of reward is to look ahead to a greater promise of reward. So again, it's not only about resisting, it's also about pursuing Christ. In Christ, when we obey God, we have so much more pleasure, so much more unentangled pleasure that's filled with shame and guilt, and it feels good for a minute, and then you feel terrible for the next day or the next week or whatever. God's pleasure is so much more pure, it's so much more long-lasting, and it's based in truth. The fourth thing I would say is don't underestimate the practical stuff. Yeah, like TV, like just watching commercials is just can incite all kinds of passions. All of a sudden you're watching some normal show and then boom, there's some lingerie commercial on there. If you don't guard your eyes against these, you know, simple things that we constantly see all the time, it's going to affect you in a really big way. You know, we have to, like, not feed that fire. We have to starve the bad and feed the good. So you have to be extremely wise and practical about what you're allowing into yourself. Don't underestimate the practical stuff. Are you going through your phone, scrolling through, and then Yahoo throws in this seductive ad? You know, maybe that app is just not for you. You have to really pay attention to the things that are easy to overlook. The fifth and final thing I would say is that you have to remember who you are in Christ. This, again, is advice that applies to all of life. Whenever we need to overcome temptation or do something that's hard, we ultimately have to remember who Jesus Christ has made us through his gospel. The Bible says when we put our faith in Jesus Christ and he saves us by his grace, we become a new creation. And what that means is those old desires that come up, those urges that you sometimes feel are not the real you anymore. There's a new you who's in Christ and who has totally different desires. And you're still going to feel the old sinful nature. But to overcome that, you have to say, no, that is not who I am. I have to remember who I am in Jesus Christ. I don't want that sin. I don't want that lifestyle. And sometimes when I feel those urges to go back there, you have to remember, that's not who I am. I am a new child of God. I'm a son of God. I'm a daughter of God. He's made me pure. He's made me righteous. You have to go to the Word and remember what's true. Well, we are obviously just scratching the surface on all the things that can help you overcome sexual temptation, like masturbation. And what I've done is I wrote a book called Redeemed Like David, How to Overcome Sexual Temptation. And it's a book that goes through Psalms 51. And if you don't know, Psalms 51 is David's prayer of repentance. David sins sexually with Bathsheba and does all kinds of crazy things. Eventually, he comes to his senses, and he writes Psalms 51. And in Psalms 51, it is like a blueprint on how to repent of sin in general, and including sexual sin. So I go through that passage of scripture verse by verse, and it's just a really in-depth study that I will encourage you to do if sexual temptation is something you're trying to overcome. Each chapter has some discussion questions that are really designed for a small group setting, but they're awesome for individual use as well. And in the back of the book, I actually even have a leader's guide with a bunch of answers to the questions that correspond to each chapter. I give this book away for free on my website in the ebook version, but if you're a paperback guy like me, I kind of like reading it in my hands. I also have a paperback version available on Amazon. I think it's selling for like $9.99, so it's pretty affordable. If that's something that's interesting to you, I'll leave some links in the description.
Oh! listening experience of Ripley. First, let's check the left-right balance of your speakers. You will hear a click sound, which will play from both channels at the same volume. Facing your speakers, you should hear the click sound coming directly between your two loudspeakers. Adjust the balance control if necessary. To double check, let's listen to that click sound again. Phase test. Now let's check that the polarity of your hi-fi system is correct by performing a phase check. You will now hear some white noise alternating between out of phase and in phase, beginning with out of phase. When in phase, you will hear the white noise in the center between your two loudspeakers. When out of phase, you will hear the sound coming directly from each speaker. Kilohertz test tone. This frequency is used to check the signal level of your system. This test is used to check things like output voltage and signal to noise ratio. Crosstalk of your system. In this test, you will hear a note of 440 Hz. You will first hear it from the left channel. Let's check how much crosstalk you have by listening to the sound coming from your right speaker. The lower the sound you have coming from the other loudspeaker, the better the crosstalk. Let's play the test tone again, but from the right speaker. Check how much sound is now coming out of the left loudspeaker. We'll now play a 3 kHz test tone to detect any rotational problems with your turntable. A turntable with a steady and stable rotation will play with a fixed frequency at a constant pitch and timbre. The more unstable the rotational speed, the more unstable the pitch you will hear. Now, we will play a short silent track in order to check the background noise of your hi-fi system. This silent track is used to check for rumble or hum coming from your turntable. Finally, let's check for standing waves in your listening room. In this test, a sweep tone will be played, moving from 20 Hz to 1 kHz. The more steady and constant the volume of the tone, the less interference from standing waves will be a problem.